Did Oppenheimer propose the existence of black holes before Einstein? And what does the J actually stand for? Turns out there's a lot we didn't know about the father of the atomic bomb. J. Robert Oppenheimer was born on April 22, 1904 in New York. As told in Kai Bird and Martin J. Sherwin's biography American Prometheus, Oppenheimer displayed both an aptitude for science and a predisposition for physical illness that did not go unnoticed by his protective parents. As a result, he was prohibited from playing with other children and spent most of his youth studying alone or in the company of his mother. His encounters with his grandfather Benjamin ultimately served as the catalyst for his lifelong career as a scientist. Seeing the scientific potential in his grandson as he observed him playing with wooden blocks, Benjamin decided to gift Oppenheimer with a starter rock collection. This sparked the young boy's interest in mineral collecting. However, Oppenheimer quickly realized that he was more invested in the structures of crystals than in the rocks that he possessed. After some years, Oppenheimer found himself corresponding with prominent geologists in New York. This led to them nominating Oppenheimer for membership in the New York Mineralogical Club and inviting him to give a lecture. However, the geologists were unaware that they were discussing the complexities of Central Park rock formations with a 12-year-old boy. The reluctant child was convinced by his father to show up at the meeting, simultaneously amusing the audience with his youthfulness and wowing them with his expertise. In 1925, Oppenheimer sailed to England to continue his education at Cambridge University, after practically breezing through his classes at Harvard. The speed at which he completed his Harvard courses actually made things more difficult for him later, as it meant he had glossed over some of the fundamental knowledge he would need at Cambridge and beyond. Worse, he was turned down as a mentee by Nobel laureate Ernest Rutherford, who was not impressed by his credentials. This, in addition to being forced to do laboratory work and sit through lectures, contributed to Oppenheimer's growing dissatisfaction with his life away from home. The negative shift in Oppenheimer's temperament reached its ugly climax in an incident that he recounted to his friend Francis Ferguson, according to American Prometheus. Per his own admission, Oppenheimer injected an apple with poison and left it on the desk of his mentor, Patrick Blackett. Despite saying that he actually liked Blackett very much, Oppenheimer hated that his tutor kept making him do more of the hands-on lab work he so despised. Luckily, Oppenheimer's attempt at Blackett's life failed, as the latter did not consume the fruit. Had it not been for the intervention of Oppenheimer's father, the budding physicist would have been not just expelled, but also charged with attempted murder. Instead, the university put Oppenheimer on probation and required him to see a London-based psychiatrist on a regular basis. Black holes have become such a staple of both scientific discussions and popular culture that it may be hard to imagine a time when scientists weren't even fully aware of their existence.
The tidal forces near the black hole are strong enough that it will tear you apart tidally, even well outside the event horizon.
Perhaps it's even more bizarre that Albert Einstein once asserted that such cosmic phenomena were impossible. Interestingly, it was Oppenheimer and his colleague Hartland Snyder who proposed the idea that these astronomical objects could exist. They published their analysis mere months after Einstein published his own attempt at proving that they couldn't. In an ironic twist, they used Einstein's theory of general relativity as the foundation of their musings. In their 1939 work on continued gravitational contraction, Oppenheimer and Snyder pondered the end of a massive star's life. Instead of it collapsing into a white dwarf, the co-authors proposed that the dying star would progressively contract due to its own gravity, at a rate that would prevent even light from escaping from it. Basically, they were thinking about black holes nearly 30 years before the term black hole would even be coined by physicist John A. Wheeler. While it was by no means a perfect paper, they were definitely onto something. Unsurprisingly, no one paid much attention to Oppenheimer's paper at the time, and it was an area of research he would never revisit.
Science will never regress, and freedom itself will never be wholly lost.
Given Oppenheimer's scientific significance, it may be surprising to know that he never received a Nobel Prize. He was nominated 3 times for the prestigious award in the field of physics. This may understandably seem like a gross injustice that can never be corrected, since the prize can only be awarded posthumously if it was announced before the recipient's death. However, a closer look at Oppenheimer's track record prior to the Manhattan Project reveals why he never won. For starters, despite the fact that he did receive acclaim in the scientific community as a pioneering mind in theoretical physics, the volume of his actual published research was less than impressive. While speaking to the Los Alamos National Laboratory, historian James Konietka offered this explanation. Many of his colleagues and critics point out that his production of significant papers was surprisingly thin. Konietka went on to add that the number of papers Oppenheimer co-authored with his students far exceeded that of his solo research works. Plus, Oppenheimer never published a breakthrough discovery or proof of an existing theory. Basically, while there was no question about Oppenheimer's brilliance, his work simply didn't exhibit what the Nobel Committee was looking for. In 1947, Oppenheimer accepted an offer from the Institute for Advanced Study, or IAS, at Princeton, New Jersey. Oppenheimer was the Institute's third director, as well as its longest-serving one. He held the position from 1947 to 1966. Aside from presenting himself with a new career challenge, it also helped that the position came with an annual salary of $20,000, as well as rent-free use of a three-story manor as his residence. Interestingly, the job was pitched to him by Louis Strauss, the man who would later spearhead the infamous 1954 trial that stripped Oppenheimer of his security clearance and cast doubt on his loyalty to the United States. Under Oppenheimer's leadership, the IAS saw an increase in inspired young physicists, encouraging an atmosphere of fast-paced idea development. In a 1955 interview with broadcast journalist Edward R. Murrow, Oppenheimer likened the IAS to a decompression chamber, saying, "It is to help men who are creative and deep and active and struggling scholars and scientists to get the job done that it is their destiny to do."
Science has profoundly altered the conditions of man's life.
It's one thing to be grilled by your own government in an attempt to prove that you committed treasonous acts, but it's another matter entirely to see it being artistically reimagined for entertainment. Perhaps that's why Oppenheimer was so incensed by a play based on the transcript of the 1954 Atomic Energy Commission hearings that he threatened to sue its playwright. Crafted by German writer Heinrich Kipphart, In the Matter of J. Robert Oppenheimer was first shown to audiences in 1964 in Berlin and Munich, and was later released as a TV movie in 1981. At the time of its premiere, Oppenheimer was still serving as the director of New Jersey's Institute for Advanced Study. To say that he was displeased by its portrayal of the proceedings is an understatement. According to a 1964 story in Time magazine, Oppenheimer took particular offense at what he labeled as improvisations which were contrary to history and to the nature of the people involved. This included the way the play claimed that physicist and Manhattan Project team member Niels Bohr had reservations about Oppenheimer's endeavor, allegedly due to the shadow of government interference looming over them. Oppenheimer also rejected the play's portrayal of him as someone who regretted his part in Los Alamos. According to the New York Review, the producers responded by omitting offending passages from Kipphart's play to appease Oppenheimer. Ultimately, the case didn't push through. Oppenheimer will forever be associated with the atomic bomb and nuclear warfare, but it isn't the only way his name has been immortalized in science. For starters, there's asteroid 67085 Oppenheimer. Located in the region of space between Mars and Jupiter, it was discovered on January 4, 2000 at the Nesca Observatory in Switzerland. His name has also been used to identify a specific impact crater on the Moon. Found on the Moon's far side, the Oppenheimer crater seems to be almost circular, based on its appearance on the lunar far side chart. Formerly known as Crater 382, the International Astronomical Union approved its name change in 1970. But one doesn't need to look to the stars to find additional scientific tributes to Oppenheimer. Oppenheimerite is a pale greenish-yellow uranium mineral with a glass-like luster and an elongated, prism-like external shape. Initially found in Utah's Blue Lizard Mine in San Juan County, it is said to be incredibly hard to find. Aside from possessing a novel crystal structure, Oppenheimerite is easily dissolvable in water. When the New York Times published an article about J. Robert Oppenheimer's life 2 days after his death in 1967, it began with this rather curious line. "Starting precisely at 5:30 a.m. Mountain War Time, July 16, 1945, J. for nothing, Robert Oppenheimer." So this raises the question, what does the J and J. Robert Oppenheimer stand for? One would think this shouldn't even be a topic for discussion. After all, as American Prometheus confirms, the physicist's birth certificate officially states that his full name is Julius Robert Oppenheimer, with his first name taken from his father. Interestingly, though, the physicist provided a peculiar answer to questions about his first initial on multiple occasions. The J stands for nothing. In fact, per the Los Alamos National Laboratory, Oppenheimer asserted to the U.S. Patent Office in a 1946 note that J was the entirety of his first name. With that said, it didn't really matter much to Oppenheimer or his colleagues, who preferred to call him Robert or Oppie. Whatever the true reason may have been regarding Oppenheimer's insistence that his first name was simply J, it certainly wasn't a hint of any cracks in his relationship with his father. In fact, until his death in 1937, Julius maintained solid connections to his sons. As recounted in American Prometheus, during his probationary period at Cambridge, J. Robert Oppenheimer was required to see a Harley Street psychiatrist. Unfortunately, they determined that Oppenheimer was exhibiting signs of dementia praecox, an obsolete and accurate term for schizophrenia. Around this time, Oppenheimer was having suicidal thoughts, a state that he later admitted was becoming chronic. Curiously, Oppenheimer maintained that he felt no guilt in the role he played in the development of the atomic bomb. He felt that the pursuit of knowledge was an organic necessity, even if it led to the creation of such a horrific weapon.
"Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds."
However, he also asserted that the Los Alamos scientists had a responsibility to help the world navigate the grave crisis through global atomic energy regulation initiatives and solidarity in the scientific community. Tragically, it may have been the 1954 security trials that ended up breaking Oppenheimer's spirit. questioned for 27 hours about his past connections with left-leaning parties, Oppenheimer admitted that the trial had left him with very little sense of self. As physicist Freeman Dyson wrote in the New York Review, Oppenheimer was sick and depressed in his twilight years, and not just because of the throat cancer that would eventually kill him. Dyson wrote, "His days as a scientist were over. It was too late to cure his anguish with equations." In 2022, 55 years after Oppenheimer's death, the U.S. Secretary of Energy overturned the decision to revoke his security clearance. If you or someone you know is struggling or in crisis, help is available. Call or text 988 or chat 988lifeline.org.